The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We are glad to see you today, glad that you gave up the warm-up to the pregame, pregame show before the Super Bowl. But you'll get home in time to see at least the game, we think. So why don't you stand up now and greet one another and tell one another if you're rooting for the Patriots or the Falcons or you don't care. You aren't on.
Oh, I'm not on. Oh, I know. I'm not on. It's not operator error. It's pastor error. Now I'm on. Nope.
Okay, I'll go. Okay, so while you fill out the friendship pads, one thing you could fill out as it goes by is for Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. The sheets are no longer in the bulletin, but we're still hoping you'll join us to be either a guest or a host on February 18. So just sign up, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, guest or host, if it's in there. Then a reminder, just what's after worship today. We have coffee and conversation in the gathering space. We hope you'll continue your conversations there. And then there's Sunday school for all ages, and I'll let you pick it up there.
Where did you leave off?
Sunday school for all ages.
Did so you do this?
Yes.
Okay.
Arts.
All right. I have a battery in now. Just for you to notice that there are quite a few things in the arts happening in the next few weeks. Second Fridays at Second resumes, and it's this Friday. Or this coming Friday. Faith and Film, our 4 weeks of Faith and Film begin next Sunday. And then if you would read about our the art show that we're going to have in the Cloister Walk during Lent, there is a way for you to participate, and so we invite you to do that as well. And Emily Witt has an announcement for us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you, Emily.
And then just a reminder, while you're signing up, while you're getting your coffee, there are samples, and today our Second Church sportswear, these are jackets and pullovers and polo shirts. Put your orders in out there. You can do that today or next Sunday, but there are samples, lots of them, so you can see what you're getting in the gathering space. And then, of course, today we have the joy of celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper together. I would just point you to this green box as far as some instructions, but mainly it's just come forward and at your own pace and receive. There's instructions there if you've got concerns about gluten, where to go. If you'd prefer to stay in your pews, an elder will come and bring the elements to you. If you'd prefer a blessing rather than to partake, just come to where Sophie or I are and cross your arms and we'll bless you. The main thing we always say is that you all indeed are welcome at Christ's table. And then a few, several prayer concerns, all about sisters. So just to share with you, we will remember Arloa
Hymans,
who is Lori Ellingson's sister, who is suffering with cancer, and Lori is going to go out to Phoenix and be with her. And then, well, it's not all sisters, all siblings, excuse me. Jim Vermeer and sister Judy passed away last Sunday, so we'll remember the Vermeers this time. That's also Trixana Wong's aunt, so we'll remember them. And then Herb Brahm's brother Don passed away, and the visitation today is 1 to 4, and the service tomorrow is at 10:30 at Third Church. So remember those families in these difficult times. How about you? Do you have things you'd like to share with us, announcements, things for our prayers? Let us worship God.
Children.
The waters of new life. The stories of salvation. The feast of our future. People of God, rejoice, for God is in our midst.
Trusting that God is merciful and gracious, we can come before God honestly and boldly. So let us join together in our prayer of confession. Let us pray. We come to your table today, Lord, knowing that we come not because we are worthy, but because by your grace you have invited us. Your table extends across the world. To your children of every nation and race, forgive us when we come feeling entitled. Forgive us when we judge or condemn others who are different. Forgive us when we are forgetful and selfish. May we go out from this place as beggars who have found bread and are eager to share your bread with others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now receive this good news. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to observe your righteous ordinances. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and made new. Alleluia. 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 And then, as forgiven people, God's law no longer accuses us, but rather guides us into grateful living. So hear how God would have us live. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Do not make or bow down and worship graven images. Do not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honor your father and mother. Do not kill. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not lie. Do not covet. Or hear also what our Lord Jesus Christ says. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength. This is the first, the great commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Amen.
Amen. Children, will you come forward? Come closer. Can you boys come a little closer this way? The Lord be with you. Oh my, you must be tired this morning. Can we do that again? The Lord be with you and also with you. Well, it's so good to see all of you. Say, I have a question. How many of you have ever been sick? Yes? What's it like when you're sick, Jackson? Oh, you're not Jackson. I'm sorry. There's Jackson. I mistook you. You're Dylan. No. Bobby. Oh, you're Bobby. I'm sorry, Bobby. What's it like when you're sick? It hurts, okay? Have you ever had fever? Yeah? Yes. Have you ever thrown up? Yeah. Have you ever felt like you need to sleep a lot? Yes. It's no fun being sick, is it? And what do you do when you're sick? You rest? You read, okay? Okay, but I'm asking, what do you do to get better? What do you do? Sometimes you take medicine. Do you ever go to the doctor? Not really? I guess not if you're not so sick. Okay, all right. Wash your hands so you won't have germs. You know, back in the old days, back when Jesus was on the earth, there weren't that many doctors, and Jesus met many people who were sick, and he would often touch them and say, be well. Or he would say, we well. Yes, sometimes he would heal them. There's all kinds of ways. Sometimes he made mud and put it on their eyes. Sometimes he touched them. Sometimes he would just simply say, be well, and they became better. And, you know, that's called healing. And sometimes when we don't know or medicine isn't good for what we have, sometimes we also pray and say, Jesus, please make me well. Please heal me. Or we do that for someone else. We do that every Sunday, actually, for a lot of people who are sick. And sometimes they get better, and sometimes they don't. What? I forgot you? Yes, what do you want to say? You had a tummy ache. Well, next time your brother or sister or your friend is sick, why don't you make sure that they're taking good care of themselves, but also pray for them and ask for Jesus to make them better. Your sister's sick today? Well, shall we pray for her then? Let's do that. Everybody hold hands. All right. Jackson, this time it's you. Let's hold hands. Okay. Dear God, we thank you for the fact that Jesus healed so many people, making them well and able to praise you. And today especially, we pray for Chiara that she would feel better soon, and for so many in our church who are sick and people in hospitals and nursing homes. We know that you love them and that you touch them with your peace and your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand up, everyone, and let's turn around and receive our blessing, okay? Can you turn around, everyone? Congregation, will you bless your children? You are God's beloved child. With you, God is well pleased. I think you can go to children and worship or back to your pew. And sorry, Bobby.
2 weeks after that first surgery, I had a second surgery. And basically what I've been told is that that tumor has been removed, that they feel that at least the cancer in that area, it is now gone. I'm Rich Clendenning, 76 years of age, and in with respect to a very beautiful note that I received this past week, I'm a member of the Cancer Club.
Continue in the narrative lectionary this winter. We come to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 7. Two stories of Jesus healing. So listen now for the Word of God. After Jesus had finished all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. A centurion was there who had a slave whom he valued highly and who was ill and close to death. When he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders to him, asking him to come and heal the slave. When they came to Jesus, they appealed to him earnestly, saying, "He is worthy of having you do this for him, for he loves our people, and it is he who built our synagogue for us." and Jesus went with them. But when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore, I do not presume to come to you, but only speak the word, and let my servant be healed. For I also am a man with authority, a man set under authority with soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes. And to my slave, do this, and the slave does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him. And turning to the crowd that followed him, he said, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith." When those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the slave in good health. Soon afterwards, Jesus went into a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went with him. As he approached the gate of the town, a man who had died was being carried out. He was his mother's only son, and she was a widow, and with her was a large crowd from the town. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, "Do not weep." Then he came forward and touched the bier, and the bearer stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, rise." The dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. Fear seized all of them, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen among us, and God has looked favorably upon his people." This word about Jesus spread throughout Judea and all the surrounding country. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Today, we continue, as you heard a few moments ago, in Luke's gospel. We continue to follow Jesus' ministry. And in these two stories, we have the juxtaposition of two very different situations. A kind of study in contrast, if you will. The Gospel of Luke often does this. It tells stories in pairs. Or it tells stories where there are two characters. Think, for example, of Mary's song, or Mary's Magnificat, followed by Zechariah's song. Or still yet again, the story of Simeon and Anna. Or Jesus' encounter with the widow of Zarephath, followed by Jesus' encounter with Naaman, the Syrian. Google it sometime. Pairs in the Gospel of Luke, and you will see numerous examples. So listen, if you will, for the next few moments to the contrasts in the stories that we heard today. In the first story, there is a man, a Gentile, a Roman centurion whose slave is very ill. In the second story, there is a woman, a widow, who has just lost her only son. The Roman centurion represents power and might, part of the military occupation of the land. He is a man with 100 soldiers under his command, a man with authority. The widow of Nain, on the other hand, is one of the poorest of the poor, a woman who has lost every kind of physical or financial support, first by the death of her husband, and then the death of her only son. The healing of the centurion's servant or slave happens in Capernaum, a medium-sized city on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. It was the home of the fishermen, Peter and Andrew, James and John. And it became Jesus' home base for ministry after he left Nazareth. A Roman garrison was stationed there. It was the center of administration and commerce. The raising of the widow's son happens in Nain, a small, insignificant Jewish village to the southwest of the Sea of Galilee. Nain was not famous or important in any way. The Roman centurion requests healing for his slave through Jewish intermediaries who have vetted him and tell Jesus that he is worthy of being helped. After all, he is a patron of their synagogue, and he has been good to their people. The centurion really never appears before Jesus, knowing that as a person with authority, all he has to do is give a command, and something will be done. Jesus also, as a man with authority, can do the same thing. The widow of Nain, on the other hand, never asks anyone for anything. She has nothing to offer, nothing to give, no authority. She's simply part of the funeral procession of mourners going through the village. When Jesus' followers run into the procession, Jesus is moved by the widow's plight, moved to compassion. The centurion's slave is healed from a distance. Jesus never sees or touches him. But Jesus walks up to the funeral pyre where the son of the widow is laid, and he touches it and commands the young man to get up. Finally, in the story, it is Jesus who is amazed to find faith in a Gentile. "I tell you," he says, "not even in Israel have I found such faith." At the end of the story of the widow of Nain, it is the crowd that is amazed. "A great prophet has risen among us." Do you hear all the contrasts? All the differences in both of these healing stories? What are we to make of them? Why does Luke put these and so many things like that side by side? Well, let me suggest some thoughts to you. First of all, it becomes clear in the Gospel of Luke that Jesus doesn't bother with the distinctions of race, social class, nationality, power, or wealth that we obsess about. People are people. It doesn't matter if the person is a powerful outsider or a powerless insider. If the person asks for healing or doesn't. If the person displays faith or is simply engulfed in a terrible plight. Jesus acts as God's presence and power no matter who the person is. Which is to say that in both of these stories, the focus is not so much on the centurion or on the widow, about whom, after all, we know very little and we hear nothing more. The focus is on Jesus and should remain on him. This becomes even clearer when you move on to the next story, where messengers arrive from John the Baptist and ask Jesus, "Are you the one who is to come?" The answer, of course, is yes. But Jesus says to them, "Tell them that the blind receive their sight, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, and the dead are raised, and the poor have the good news proclaimed to them." This is what God's activity looks like. This is the one who is to come. And secondly, there is, I think, one final contrast that it's important for us to notice in these two stories. In the first story, the focus is on Jesus' authority. The Roman centurion knows himself to be a man with authority. He's a man who has power. That's how he gets things done. He gives a command, and it's carried out. And he trusts that Jesus, as a very special person, as a person from God, can do the same. "Say the word, and my slave will be healed." In the second story, the focus is on Jesus' compassion. When Jesus sees the widow in the procession, he is moved. Moved to compassion, to feel with her the terribleness of her plight. And he says to her, "Do not weep." He approaches someone helpless and feels their terrible loss and the powerlessness that has engulfed her. Jesus displayed that in the heart of God, there is both authority and compassion. And it's important that authority and compassion go hand in hand. Authority without compassion is at the very least dangerous and cold to the plight of the poor. At the worst, it is tyrannical and destructive. If Jesus is God in our midst, his example is always exceptional love, grace, and justice for those who are poor, hungry, who mourn, or are oppressed. But compassion without authority or without the power of God may have a difficult time standing up to the forces of death and destruction. In the book of James, we are reminded that if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking food, and someone says to them, "Go in peace, be warmed and filled," without giving them what they need, that is no good at all. Compassion needs action if the doors are to be opened to God's presence and power. A story came to my attention this week about a small town in Texas where a mosque was first burglarized and then burned to the ground about a week later. Given the politically charged atmosphere in our country right now, and recent actions about Muslims traveling or seeking refuge, this story could have exemplified the very worst instincts in our nation. However, what happened was just the opposite. Instead, the president of the local Jewish synagogue presented the imam of the mosque with the keys to their house of worship, thus giving that small Muslim community a home while they were homeless. What's more, an online campaign raised more than $900,000 so that that community can begin rebuilding again. In those actions, the community showed compassion, but also authority, the power to act. I wonder, my friends, what we should do as a community that claims both God's power but also compassion in offering healing to this world. I invite you to think and to pray in these times in the ways in which you can feel for those who struggle, but act as well. For these are times that call for both. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, I invite you now to stand and say what you believe, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, was born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us lift up our hearts to God in prayer. Oh God, today we are reminded that you came among us in Jesus the healer. And there is so much in this world and in our lives that need healing. So Christ the healer, touch this world where conflict is solved with bombs and guns, where people live with fear of their enemies, where children and the innocent are often fodder for the conflict of the powerful. Heal this world so racked by the power of the evil one. Heal, O God, lands where there is hunger and famine, where people do not have even the simplest things to get by in daily life. For the children of Haiti who go to school, for the churches in Mexico that give witness, for our friends who work tirelessly in the Middle East. Lord, to the hungry, give bread. And to those of us who are full, give a hunger for justice. Remember, Lord, also those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. We think of those who are in prison, in hospitals, in psychiatric institutions, those who are alone in many ways. remember those who grieve, and especially today we remember the Blom and the Vermeer families. We pray for Lori's sister, Arloa. And for whom else shall we pray? Finally, we pray for ourselves. Lord, you know our needs even before we know them. You know sometimes our selfishness, our ignorance in asking. So, Lord, we pray for what we need. If it is wisdom or strength, if it is the ability to forgive, if it is a generous heart, if it is for that broken relationship, for a job, Lord, hear our prayers. And finally, O God, hear us as together we say the words that Jesus, our teacher, our Savior, our friend, taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, Scripture says God loves a cheerful giver. So with joy and with gratitude, let us bring our tithes, our offerings to the Lord.
Thank you.
great God, you are generous, you are loving, you are faithful. We thank you that you give us this opportunity to know those things as well by being givers today. So take these gifts, and along with them, take our time and our talents, our hearts, our whole selves, that we may serve the name of Jesus in this world. We pray it in his name. Amen.
He was always the guest. In the homes of Peter and Jairus, Martha and Mary, Joanna and Susanna, Jesus was always the guest. At the meal tables of the wealthy, where he pled the case of the poor, he was always the guest. Upsetting polite company, befriending isolated people, welcoming the stranger, Jesus was always the guest. But here at this table, he is the host. Those who wish to serve him must first be served by him. Those who want to follow him must first be fed by him. Those who would wash his feet must first let him make them clean. For this is the table where God intends for us to be nourished. This is the time when Christ can make us new. So come, you who hunger and thirst for a deeper faith, for a better life, for a fairer world. Jesus Christ, who has sat at our tables, now invites us to his.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good to give God thanks and praise.
Gratitude, praise, hearts lifted high, voices full and joyful. These you deserve, Almighty God, Creator and Ruler of the universe. In the beginning, your word brought forth light from the darkness. You gave us the sun to rule the day and the moon and the stars to illumine the night. Your brightness shines in all that is true. Your goodness warms our hearts. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, to be the light of the world. He is the reflection of your glory, and in him your imprint is untarnished. The burden of human sorrow and suffering could not dim his light. The world was dark at his death, but he rose from the grave with radiant power, beaming with new life. For this and all your countless blessings, we praise you, joining our voices with the choirs of heaven and the faithful from every time and place to sing. Most merciful God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered once upon a cross by our Lord Jesus Christ for the sin of the whole world.
Your death, Lord Jesus, we remember. Your resurrection, we celebrate. Your coming in glory, we await.
And now you prepare a table for us, offering not just bread and wine, but your very self, so we may be nourished, filled, and raised with you.
Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, making us into living and holy sacrifices, burning for your glory.
We do now what you did in an upstairs room. By your Holy Spirit, may we receive in this bread and cup the full communion of the body of Christ.
Make us one with all who share this feast, here at this table, at tables around the world, and with those who feast in glory. Unite us to serve you and shine with your love until the day when you return to gather your whole church around your table. Come quickly, Lord Jesus.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And after he had given thanks and blessed it, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant poured out in my blood for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are now ready. Beloved in the Lord, Christ has fed us at his life-giving table, so let us offer heartfelt thanks and praise. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and remember all God's blessings, who heals our bodies, who forgives our sins, who crowns us with love and mercy, and even gave us his Son and all things through him. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Now may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God's countenance be lifted upon you and bring you peace. Go now in peace. Amen.